we're just biological machines. We're materialist machines. We are complicated ones beyond imagination. But yeah, that's all there is. And nobody arguing for free will can come up with something that does not rely upon a magical step of nonsense somewhere in the analysis.
Mm-hmm. Much of this comes down to the definition of free will. So what would be your definition of free will?
It's one that infuriates the philosophical compatibilists, the one who say, yes, it's a material world, but somehow that's compatible with free will. It's infuriating to them. In fact, 2 weeks ago, I had a debate with Daniel Dennett.
In case you didn't know, I've spoken to Daniel Dennett for about 3 hours. It's a large behemoth podcast, and it's already out. The link is in the description.
In fact, 2 weeks ago, I had a debate with Daniel Dennett, who's one of the most, you know, visible of philosophy compatibilists, and he actually used the word daft. He said I was being daft in insisting on this as a definition of free will, whereas for me, I think is the only possible thing. Okay, so a behavior happens, and you ask, why did that occur? Did that person just exercise free will? Where did that behavior come from? And you're asking, what went on in the brain a second ago? But you're also asking, what in the environment over the previous minutes to hours triggered that behavior? And you're also asking, what did this morning's hormone levels have to do with how sensitive the brain would be to that? And then you're asking, what have previous months been about in terms of true neural plasticity? You're asking about adolescence and childhood and even fetal life, where what was going on then was directing the brain you had at this moment. You're asking something about genes. You're asking something about the culture your ancestors invented, because that was going to influence how your mother was mothering you within minutes of birth, and it turns out that makes a difference. Why did that behavior occur? Because of everything from a second ago to a million years ago. And how does one then define free will? If you want to prove there's free will, show me that this brain just produced a behavior, and show me it would have produced the exact same behavior independent of its history leading up to it. That moment. Change that morning's hormone levels, change the genome, change what the fetal environment was like, change the color of the socks that person is wearing today, change all of those. And if you still get the exact same behavior, you've just proven free will, because you've demonstrated behavior that is being an uncaused cause that is independent of its history. And you can't. And nobody who argues for free will can show how that occurs, because it is so embedded in this matrix of everything that got you to that moment that there's simply no wiggle room in there to say, and then for half a second, biology and the physical laws of the universe, it gets turned off for half a second, and then you decide to do what you do.
Uh-huh. So what would be some of the alternative definitions of free will that don't rely on uncaused causation?
Oh, you not only have alternatives, but you are aware that you have alternatives, that you are not being coerced, that you understand what the consequences are likely to be. I mean, that's what our legal system runs on, which makes no sense whatsoever. I mean, often after, you know, a trial is about, did this person do this or not? It then comes down to, did they intend to do that? Did they know what the likely consequences were going to be? And did they realize they didn't have to do that? Nobody was holding a gun to their head. And if the answer is yes to those, for at least the American legal system, you have culpability, you have responsibility, and it is fine to convict you. And none of it asks, where did that person's intent come from? And for the legal system, free will is, you knew you were doing it, and you knew what the likely outcome was going to be, and you knew you didn't have to do it. There were alternatives. And that's a pathetically misguided medieval notion of the gears, the nuts and bolts of how we make decisions and how we become who we are. Like, there's another range in which there is this hugely seductive magnet that pulls people towards believing they're seeing free will, which is that most people are willing to admit, Yeah. There's some stuff we had no control over. You had no control over how tall you are or what your digit memory span is like, or if you're a sprinter or a marathon runner or neither, and if you have perfect pitch and what color your eyes are. Yeah. There's all this stuff that we were handed. Yeah, that's biology that you were gifted or cursed with or whatever. Yeah, you had no control over that. But then what do you do with it? Do you show tenacity? Do you show self-discipline? When the going gets tough, do you get going? Or are you in someone who is gifted in all these ways? And then you're self-indulgent and you squander all of it. And it is this massively false dichotomy that there are attributes that you were given, which are biological, over which you had no control. And what you then do with them is made of the stuff that's made out of magic. And this dichotomy is utterly false, because what you do with your opportunities, whether you show self-control or self-indulgence, whether you have emotional regulation, whether you're good at long-term planning, whether you always miss the opportunity to do something, or if you never miss the opportunity to miss an opportunity, in all those cases, that's anchored in neurobiology as well, a part of the brain called the frontal cortex, which has a hell of a lot to do with whether at junctures in life, you're going to make the right decision in the face of a more tempting alternative. And the frontal cortex and how it became what it is in your brain is completely the outcome of 1 second before and a million years before as well. It's made of the same biology. It's not a separate domain. And there's this temptation that for people, an awful lot of them, what free will is, oh, you're given these attributes, what you choose to do with it. And because that's inspiring as hell. You look at somebody who grew up under awful circumstances, and yet somehow they surmounted it with incredible self-discipline. And it's moving, and it's inspirational, and it's wonderful, and all of that. But all that happened is they lucked out that that part of their brain happened to be good at what was needed to beat enormous odds against them and pull this off. It's the same biology. It's brain yuck and cells and molecules, and it's the exact same thing. And all you have to do to appreciate it is look at a finding that is just astonishing in terms of the frontal cortex makes you say, don't do it, don't do it. I know it's tempting. Don't do it. Hold out. You're not going to regret it. This is going to be great if you can just show some self-discipline. You take five-year-olds and the socioeconomic status of their parents is already a significant predictor of how well their frontal cortex works, how thick the layers are of it, its metabolic rate, and what direction does that correlation go? No surprise. If you are born into poverty, by age 5, on the average, you're going to have elevated stress hormone levels compared to everyone else. By age 5, those stress hormones have a hell of a lot to do with how your frontal cortex develops. And at age 5, you were already paying the frontal cortical price of having chosen the wrong family to have gotten born into, because it is more stressful and adverse to be raised in poverty than not. And your frontal cortex is already paying the price for it. And already at 5 years of age, the socioeconomic status of one's parents is already a predictor of how well your frontal cortex does the harder thing when it's the right thing to do. Whoa, that's just free will. That's just Calvinistic gumption and backbone. It's the same biology and environment and the same. Some of us had much better luck than others, and there's nothing to it more or less than that.
What are the implications for morality of this view?
Well, this is where things get fairly contentious, because this is where I leave far behind what would be viewed as sort of a progressive, liberal, incremental sort of approach, which is one of edge cases. Yeah. In general, we believe there's free will, but keep in mind some people have less free will than other people, or keep in mind that in some circumstances, we all have less free will than normal. And yeah, just keep in mind those when you're making no. If there's no free will, blame and punishment make no sense whatsoever. Praise and reward make no sense whatsoever. Nobody has earned anything. Nobody is entitled to anything. Nobody's needs deserve more consideration than anyone else's. And just as minor side shows, the criminal justice system makes no sense intellectually or morally. And just as much so with the mirror, meritocracies make no sense intellectually or morally. And we currently run the world where we think it is okay to treat some people much better than average because of things they had nothing to do with, and other people much worse than average likewise. And not only do we do that, but then we slather them with hypocrisy about how this is a just world and people get what they have earned. And you have to have an unrecognizably different world. And I recognize that if one is going to accept none of us are entitled to better treatment than anybody else, and hating somebody makes as little sense as hating a virus that's good at getting into your lungs, because none of that makes sense within a standpoint of we are just biological machines that have arrived at this moment.
To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.